Hi everyone, welcome to the 13th and the last episode of the Talks with the Experts video series. My name is Eva and today I'm here with the data scientist Viktor. Thank you for joining us today.
Sure, I'm happy to be here.
This is actually the second time we're talking about data, and in this episode we will be talking about why we completely changed the A/B testing methodology, which is certainly an interesting topic. But before we start, please be sure to check the Facebook group called Free-to-Play Game Developers, which you can join and talk with Viktor about this topic. The link is below the video. So Viktor, tell us, why did we actually change the A/B testing methodology? What are the reasons?
Well, the main reason is that the new method, the Bayesian method, is just much more practical in business applications. We were using before the frequentist approach, which is great in scientific research, but it has several issues which are just impractical in business. If you want to be flexible and quick with the testing and production, then it's not the best. The one thing is that it can happen with the frequentist test that when the result is insignificant, you basically do not know anything from statistical point of view. Like, you cannot say that version B is better, but you cannot also say that they are the same, because this is not how the test works. You can just say that you don't have enough data to tell whether there is a difference. And this sucks if you want to communicate this as a data scientist to the producer, because you just spent 2 months on testing some monetization feature and then you tell them like, okay, we didn't find out anything. So this is not what we want, because it happened to us a few times. Of course, there were other reasons, but the method itself didn't really help us. So, and the other thing is that to set up the frequentist test, you have to fix the sample size. And that works in a way that you have to estimate the effect of the feature you're testing, and by that you estimate how many players do you need in the test. And of course this is somehow strange, because we are testing because we do not know how big is the effect. So that happens quite often, that you underestimate it or overestimate it, because basically you're just guessing if you're testing a new feature. And this is not very cost effective, because either you end up with a test that is not significant, or you end up with a really big sample size and you are wasting time on the test. So these are the two main reasons why we changed it.
Okay, so you mentioned that the old method was called frequentist and the new one is Bayesian, right?
Yes, those are basically like two approaches to statistics. And yeah, so the first one was frequentist. It was more specifically, we used t-test and z-test. You can call it like that. And with Bayesian, you have a like Bayesian model that models conversion and ARPU. And this is how we do the tests.
So you mentioned two reasons why you changed the approach. Can you be please more specific? How did Bayesian help you?
Sure. The first issue was about interpreting the results. With the old method, you have the p-value as a result, and then you compare p-value to some threshold, usually like 5%. So, and if the test is insignificant, so if the p-value is higher than 5%, then statistically you don't really have a result. You don't know if there is or there is no difference. And this is not good, because then you cannot say much as a statistician. So with the Bayesian method, the result is not a p-value, but you have a probability that B is bigger than A or better than A, and then you have a expected gain or expected loss with each version. So basically you have three numbers which are really easily interpretable even to non-statisticians or anyone, and you can always at least have some informed like risk evaluation decision. Like, even if the test is not significant enough or the difference is small, you have some information you can use always. So, and the other thing was that with the sample size I mentioned, that the t-test, like I said, you have to fix the sample size before, but with Bayesian approach, it works differently. So actually it works without fixing the sample size. So you can just repeatedly look at the results and see what's there, and you can stop the result if the results are good enough for you, I would say. Like here you have to be really careful because you are not controlling the type 1 error, but you are controlling expected loss, which is the term used in Bayesian statistics. But again, this is, I think, more practical in business.
So tell us, what has actually changed here in Pixel Federation?
Okay, so by changing the methodology, now it happens to us less often that we have inconclusive tests, and almost always we have some valuable information from the results. And for example, during the soft launch of one of our games, in the past we were testing levels, the completion rate of levels, and this is something we would not be able to do with the frequentist approach, because in the soft launch we had much smaller sample sizes, much smaller player base. And this is not something I mentioned before, but actually Bayesian tests, they work much better with smaller sample sizes. Like if you set up it correctly, in some situations we can now make a test with 40% of the sample sizes before. So it's really also saving time and saving money for this. But unfortunately, I think we are not using all the potential we have with the A/B test. Like we are not testing more frequently than, for example, a year ago. And this has nothing to do with the evaluation method, whether frequentist or Bayesian, but this actually has to do with the process of the setup of the test. Like for now, it takes a lot of time for programmers and designers to set it up. So what we need is to have some practical tools for them to really set it up automatically. Just designer sets up some parameters, this is what I want to test, and the programmer doesn't have to implement anything in the app, and you can run then test much more often, and you can get more results. So this is something we would like to do in the future, actually.
So to conclude this interview, can you share with us some more tricks and tips regarding testing?
Sure. There are some like general tips which are, well, nothing special, but it's always good to remember it and to maybe question yourself when you're planning a test. Like for example, it happened to us a few times, like really talk with the designers and producers, like whether this decision or whether the result of the test will affect any decision. I mean, it really makes no sense to make an A/B test just to confirm what you want to do anyway or something like this. Mm-hmm. Then the other thing is, of course, if you have several A/B tests, then always test first the one that you guess will have the most impact, because that is the best time spent on testing. And then very interesting or very important thing is to how to select the metric. Like you always have to, when you're evaluating a test, you always have to select one metric that you're actually testing, and the others are of course like you're checking whether the other metrics didn't drop or something. But the selection of what you're gonna test is really important, because it's often like people are testing just retention, for example, because everything in game leads to retention, better or worse. But the thing is that some features really, really indirectly affect retention, and it can take time to manifest this change. So it's often better to actually make a metric that is directly connected to your feature, to your change, what you're doing. Like for example, when again we did the soft launch, we were changing how power-ups work, and this power-ups, of course, like if they work better, then the level of the flow of the level is better, so like it should affect the retention. But if we would test the retention, we wouldn't find anything out. But we just looked at how the players use the power-ups, because it was directly regarding the feature that was changed, and we actually saw the difference very clearly even without the test. So and that was in a soft launch. So again, we didn't have the time and the resources to do a good test, but it's good to think about the metrics, maybe how to do it.
So thank you, Victor, for sharing with us your insights about testing.
You're welcome.
And thank you guys for staying with us this whole season one of Talks with Experts video series. Please let us know if you like these videos or even if you didn't like these videos. We definitely want to know for the future. See ya.
See ya.
Bye bye.
And if you want to watch previous video about how we do data science in Pixel Federation, click here.